Good morning all. As Graham said there, good morning, Bright City, one and all. Well
Good
said,
morning,
Graham. Good
everyone.
morning to you all. Hi, Roger. Hi, Dave. Hi, Rebecca. Hi, Sarah. Hi, everybody. We've got at least 39 unique devices and going up. So welcome to you all. Lovely to have you here. It's a beautiful morning.
It is.
The
Good
sun is
morning,
shining.
everyone. I trust you've all had a wonderful week. And isn't it just great to come together and just be family and to share hearts and worship God and give Him glory on this beautiful Sunday morning that the Lord has given us this morning? We're just excited to be together.
It's great to be together. And from the rising of the sun, this is Psalm 113, verse 3. From the rising of the sun to the setting of the same, the name of the Lord is to be
Yeah,
praised.
that's right.
And yes, Lord, you are to be praised today on this beautiful day, as always. Thank you for your goodness
Yes,
to
Lord.
us. Thank you for your love. Thank you for this life. Thank you for your grace and mercy. Thank you for Jesus, for the cross, for the future we have in you, the hope we have in you. Thank you, Lord. And let every person who is joining us now experience your love, experience your assurance, experience even and hear the call from your Holy Spirit to be joined to you through faith in Jesus Christ. And hello, everyone. Hi, Andy. Hi, Angela. Hi, Rachel and family and Dele. Hi, Paula. Hi, Dee.
Good morning,
And
everyone.
sorry if we've missed anybody. It's great to have you. We're so excited. We've got George White going to be joining
The
us.
Reverend.
George Trevor White, the very same, will be joining us later on. So we're so excited to have him. That'll be getting on towards half past. And
Whatever.
he's a great guy. Ah, yes, no.
11.
No, I'm getting the times wrong.
He's getting
He's
his times
on the half hour. So
wrong.
lovely. Well, I've managed to get a haircut and I'm not gloating, I'm not boasting. Sorry to you guys there who are still waiting to get your haircut. I have the advantage of having a daughter who's a hairdresser and she finally managed to do a social distancing haircut, however they work. But how are you guys all managing with your hair?
Good to see you, John Knightley. Good morning,
Hey, John,
Addie.
over in China. Hi, Addie. Rachel's roots are growing out, aren't they,
Yes, I'm
darling?
trying not to put my head forward too much. No, I'm joking. It's wonderful. Anyway, I've got a little scripture that I wanted to share with you this morning. It's in Psalm 46. It's a wonderful scripture. I love this scripture. This chapter, in fact. Okay, so are you ready? This is the word of the Lord for you this morning. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, even though the earth be removed and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though its waters roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with its swelling. There is a river whose streams shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacle of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God shall help her. Just at the break of dawn, the nations raged, the kingdoms were moved. He uttered his voice, the earth melted. The Lord of hosts is with us. And it ends with this part: Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. Lord, I just want to thank you that you are King of kings and Lord of this earth. Heavenly Father, we come before you. We worship you this morning. We say, Father, take center stage. Take your place. Be the
Yes, Lord.
center of our lives, be the center of our hearts, be in the center of our thoughts. Lord, we thank you that you are seated on your throne and you will not be moved.
What jumped out at me is so much in that scripture. He says, I am very present, a very present help. So God is very present here now. He's very present with you. You can know the very present, close, intimate God for yourself. How do you do that? You just ask him. You say, Lord, I want to know you. I want to give my life to you. I want to know this very present relationship that I can have with you. Mm. Come into my life. I make you the Lord of my life, Lord Jesus Christ. And so many of us have experienced that. And, you know, we'll be hearing a story in a moment. We do the My Stories every week. So looking forward to my story in a moment. I just want to bring a notice about Tuesday Connect that's coming up this Tuesday. We're blessed at Bright City Church of having, you know, a very multi-ethnic church, you know, one of the most in the area, I would say, which is wonderful. And, you know, following the George Floyd terrible murder incident there, and then the, you know, the reactions to that, very understandable sort of reactions and pain. And then, you know, we've seen, and although we've prayed into it, you know, there have been our members of our family, church family, who have expressed, you know, very articulately the kind of the pain and the hurt that these things, you know, bringing to the fore the issue of racism and the experiences that some of our family members, you know, church family members have experienced. And I liken it, I think, to, you know, I've had the children going to school when I was a child going to school, and you might hear suddenly your child, member of your family says, yeah, I've been being bullied for so long. And there's that sort of almost, you know, dear son, dear daughter, you know, oh, I wish you'd have told me earlier. Not the sense of wish you told, but you know, the pain that is felt by the family, by the father, by us all, and wanting to know, wanting to hear, wanting to help deal with it. And I think, you know, in the spirit of that as well, you know, as a church, we want to talk about the issues. We want to hear and also give a chance for those of you in our family who have really experienced these things and are feeling that pain right now to express that. So on the Tuesday, we're going to invite, we've already spoken to a few members of our church family who have been expressing those things very articulately, to come on the broadcast and to share. And we just want to listen. We want to hear. We want to pray. We want to, you know, we want to be with you. And yeah, we're trusting God that he'll help us in this area. So do tune in for that one. It's going to be very important. And we'll spread the word, and we'll put the here's a little, in fact, a little advert type of thingy. Just it says, as you can see there, this, that's from the Bible. If one member suffers, one member of the family suffers, all the members suffer with it. And so, yeah, we want to be together in the experience and hearing about these things. Bless you. So, okay, that'll be on Tuesday, 7 o'clock till 8 o'clock p.m. Right, so going back to my story, we're so thrilled to have my story from Deborah. Enjoy this. Here it comes.
My story.
Hi, my name's Deborah. Growing up as a young child, I always went along to church with my family. I would say that I was raised in a Christian environment, and I used to attend Scripture Union Club at school. I enjoyed all the different activities that they put on for us, especially the singing. And as I grew older, I continued to attend church. In my late teens, I attended a church service, and they were talking about giving your life to Christ. And I'd never made that personal commitment. And on that evening, I did make that personal commitment, and I received Jesus Christ as my personal savior. I was very excited about this new commitment that I'd made and this new life that I was going to live for Christ. However, I did struggle, and the struggle came around my friendships. I had a lot of friends who were my age, and they were not Christians. None of them were going to church. So I struggled to sort of live this new life that I wanted to live for God. But also, I wanted to keep up with what my friends were doing. They were all going out, going to parties. They were having a lot of fun. And being a Christian at that point just seemed so boring, like there was nothing for us to do. This struggle continued for several years, and in the end, I ended up not going to church. I cut off all ties with my Christian friends because it was just so difficult. And I just felt like God was keeping a scorecard of everything that I was doing right and wrong, and I could never quite match up, you know. And this continued again for many years. I had a good life. If you looked at my life from the outside, I had everything I needed. You know, I was enjoying my life. I was young. However, I started to get a bit dissatisfied with my life. I was starting to question why I was here on this earth. You know, what was the point of my life? What was I going to do for the rest of my life? Just continue to work and earn money? Was that the whole point of my existence? The turning point came for me when I attended a church event that had been put on for young Christians. And I was just so amazed at the speakers at this event and how they were talking about God's love for them personally and how God had touched their lives and how God had changed their lives. And I just felt in my heart that I wanted to experience this same love. I wanted to experience the same experience of a loving, kind, forgiving Father who they were talking about. I rededicated my life to Jesus Christ that evening, and I've never turned back. And I know that God loves me personally. I know that God loves me unconditionally. God has plans for me, and His thoughts for me are good. God has promised that He'll never leave me nor forsake me, that He will always be with me. It doesn't matter what this life brings. I know that God is always with me. And I just really want to thank God for everything that He has done for me since I've given my life to Him. You know, there were so many things that I never thought I would be able to achieve, but God has been faithful. God's blessed me with a wonderful family of my own. God's blessed me with a wonderful church family and friends to just encourage me. And God's faithfulness has just seen most of my family members actually coming to accept Jesus Christ as their personal savior and having that personal relationship with God. And so I just really want to encourage you that it doesn't matter where you are or what you're struggling with, God does love you. And I would just encourage you to just give God a chance. You know, speak to Christians, pick up your Bible, read and pray. There are so many ways that God is trying to just connect with you. Open your heart. Thank you for listening.
Thanks, Deborah. That was so brilliant. Jesus said, "I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. No one can snatch them out of my hand." Mm-hmm. That's the very promise of Jesus. Yeah. And you can know that very same intimate love and blessed assurance from knowing Him. And in fact, we're going to be doing an alpha course where you can explore the Christian faith. You can come along on the Zoom and you can join in. And that's going to be on the 6th of July, starting on Monday at 7 p.m. So if you feel you'd like to do that, just keep watching and we'll give you more details, and you can certainly even register an interest by private messaging us on this page, and we will make sure that you can access that alpha course.
Yeah, it's just lovely to hear what Deborah was sharing about, you know, sort of, yes, she went to church as a child and even sooner, but she had to get her own encounter with God, with the living Father, and it just changed her life, you know, and that's what He wants. We've got a Father in heaven who wants that intimate relationship with Him, that you would know Him, that you would know Him as your Father, and how much He really loves and cares about you.
Yeah, beautiful. We're going to go into worship now. Let's just thank God for His love, His amazing grace. Yeah. This is Ben and Jay leading us.
There is an endless song echoes in my soul. I hear the music ring. And though the storms may come, I am holding on. sling. How can I keep from singing your praise? How can I ever say enough? How amazing is your love? How can I keep from shouting your name? I know I am loved by the King, and it makes my heart wanna sing. I will lift my eyes in the darkest night, for I know my Savior lives. And I will walk with you, knowing you'll see me through, and sing the from singing your praise. How can I ever say enough? How amazing is your love? How can I keep from shouting your name? I know I am loved by the King, and it makes my sing in the troubled times, and sing when I win. I can sing when I lose my step and fall down again. I can sing 'cause you pick me up, and sing 'cause you're there. I can sing 'cause you hear me, Lord, when I call you in prayer. I can sing with my last breath, and sing, for I know that I'll sing with the angels and the saints around the throne. How can I keep from singing your praise? How can I ever say enough? How amazing is your love? How can I keep from shouting your name? I know I am loved by the King, and it makes my heart wanna clouds. Kings and kingdoms will bow down, and every chain will break as broken hearts declare His praise. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is a lion, the Lion of Judah. He's roaring in power and fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb, the Lamb slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before Him. Way before the King of Kings. The God who comes to save is here to set the captives free. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is a lion, the Lion of Judah. He's roaring in power and fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before Him. Our God is a Lamb, the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chain, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before Him. Fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before Him. Our God is a Lamb, the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before. Our God is a Lion. Our God is a Lion, the Lion of Judah. He's roaring in power and fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before Him. Our God is a Lamb, the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. bow before him.
Thank you, Lord. We worship you. Thanks so much, Ben and Jay. And yes, we're looking forward. We've got George joining us very soon. We've got one more song to play you and an intro to that song, actually, from our own lovely daughter and son-in-law. So watch this. They're good.
Good morning, Bright City Church. It's great to be here with you. This is Josie. She's Ian and Rachel's daughter, and I'm Wes. I hope you're all doing well. I know you've got George White coming up in a moment. He and his wife, Katie, are our best, dearest friends. George was best man at our wedding, so I really look forward to hearing from him and his chat with Rachel and Ian. And Josie also has a song that she's going to be sharing with you. But just before we hear that, we just wanted to discuss the song and kind of what it means for us and our journey.
Yeah, so the song is called Peace, and really that word has been everything that God has been to me during some really difficult challenges with my health. As many of you know, I have faced some really tough moments with my health, especially in the last couple of years, and I know a lot of you have prayed for me through that, so I just wanted to say thank you. But I hope this song blesses you, because it really has been true to me, that God has been my complete peace during those really fearful, dark moments. You know, there have been some really tough times when there's seemed to be no way out, no way out with the doctors, no way out with medication, and really, you know, all we've had to rely on is God and his goodness and his peace in those tough times. So I hope it blesses and encourages you.
Stay true, even when the lies come. Your word remains true, even when my thoughts don't line up. I will stand tall on each promise you made. Let
All anxiety bows in the presence of Jesus, the keeper of peace. And peace is a promise he keeps.
Thank you, Jose. I'm so proud of you. Proud dad here. Thank you for doing that.
Yeah, and thank you, Jose. You know, all anxiety bows in your presence. I think that was one of the lines, you know. And if you've been feeling that anxiety and those fears, maybe you've been going through a bit of a dark storm, you know, his peace surpasses all understanding and it will come. You know, when we ask, he promises to answer us. And I know that that's Josie's experience in her life. Mm.
Well, we're going to welcome George to join us. If you're waiting for your cue, George, now's the time if you want to phone in. And George, well, you know, so very best friends of our daughter and son-in-law, Josie and Wesley. Here's George. So I'm going to answer that straight away. Wonderful. Here he is. Now let's...
Hi, George.
Hey, George, let's get you on the broadcast. You're now with us. So host gets the same. Where are we? Let's get the right box. Host, guest, the same.
Yes,
George, you're
George.
On.
Hello, Ashford. Yes.
Hello, get George. Him. What a man. Oh, thanks for joining us, George. This is George Trevor White.
The Reverend. The Reverend. George.
Are you addressed as Reverend George?
Apparently so. What? I mean, I've just been addressed as Reverend. I mean, not many people in our own congregation call me that. In fact, Kate still laughs when I wear a dog collar. So it's all still slightly, you know, it's right. Still quite funny to us, but there you go. Yeah.
Well, going back to when our first connections with George, and we were chatting about this the other day, when we used to go as ACF, Ashford Christian Fellowship, to Faith Camp with our youth crew, and I was youth leader and others, and George was hanging out because Cheriton Baptist Youth used to share a kind of plot with us. And so George was hanging out with Jose and Dan and stuff. We were chatting about that and some funny stories.
Yeah,
George.
I mean, I think I was getting up to mischief with Dan, actually. I think it was the first Christian thing I'd ever been invited to. And as in, you know, sort of Christian festival. And I remember going along and me and Dan in particular getting up to no good. But we won't talk about that if you don't want to.
Brilliant. Now, George, we often just get our guests to... you know, touch on their kind of journey of faith, and you're now a reverend. How did you come to know Jesus, and what, yeah, how did that all happen briefly?
Briefly, wow. Okay, so it's always funny, isn't it? Because so many things, I find that when I tell my testimony, so many things are happening at the same time, aren't they?
Yeah.
So it's quite hard to sort of talk about it in a linear way, but I'll give the sort of the main highlights.
Yeah.
And I really related to what, was it Deborah who was sharing her story earlier?
Deborah,
it's just
yeah.
amazing. And I really related to what she was saying about she's obviously had this this moment of encountering God personally, is what you know what she seemed to say. And then from there, she's seeing more and more of her family members come to faith. And I guess it's sort of the story with my family in that I didn't sort of grow up around church or anything like that. And I think the spiritual awakening, I suppose, in our family started with my mum. So my mum sadly died when I was 9, but she, about a year and a half before she died, came to know Jesus. So she was in a hospital room in Canterbury, relevant, Kent reference, there you go. you can tell I'm a local boy. And she was in hospital there, and she literally, I mean, there's so much more I could say about this, but she visibly met with Jesus in a hospital room.
Wow.
And it changed everything. I mean, the last year and a half of her life, she developed this spirituality and this relationship with God in prayer, and it's just amazing. And I actually I got a bunch of letters when I was a teenager after I had come to faith that my mum had got my aunt to dictate about this this encounter that she had. It's just the craziest thing. It's like a movie.
Wow.
But that was probably, I would say, that was really the start of a spiritual awakening in our family. And it was a number of years until I sort of got involved with church and all the rest of it. But I look back at that and think that's probably, you know, some of the origins of it. And so when I was, I mean, for me, I was 14 when I got invited to Faith Camp, the camp that you were just talking about. And I remember I was in a band with a couple of guys in my school, and one of the guitar players was a Christian, and he, you know, he kind of invited us along to this thing. We all said no, I think, straight off the bat. And then he kind of kept, like as Christians do sometimes, he kind of kept changing the offer. So he sort of said, oh, you don't have to go to any of the meetings. There's a skate park. You know, we can just... hang out and eat and play guitar. And and so by the time we said, yeah, I mean, he basically managed to sort of break
it. He took the bait.
Exactly. So we thought, great. So we went along and it was the end of that week, actually. I think it was in the Source Tent, which was a ministry that was run by Life Church, which obviously you guys know very well. Yeah. And I think it may even have been Mrs. Tina Triffitt, Wes's mum, preaching the night. And I remember, really honestly, you know, I'd gone to a Church of England primary school, I'd been to a wedding, I went to church every now and then. But I'd never really heard about Jesus. You know, it just blew my mind. I remember I was sitting in the corner of that tent, and I sort of felt like I had a rough idea, an opinion on Christianity generally.
Yeah.
But it was like this hidden secret that no one had told me about. I was like, no way. And I remember thinking, you know, I didn't, honestly, I didn't own a Bible. I didn't know the songs. I didn't know the language or anything really about church. But I remember thinking, even at that age, you know, if Jesus is what Christianity is centrally about, then I can get on board with that. And so that was it. That was sort of the start of my journey. And you know, it wasn't like a Damascus Road thing where then, it was like, there was still like a, you know, up and down and compromise and favor and all of that kind of stuff. But yeah, that
amazing.
Was kind of the start of it.
So when did you go from, you know, having that personal relationship with Jesus to sensing a call into ministry yourself? How did that kind of come about, George?
Over time. So I mean, I was never really interested in it. In terms of the Christian leadership thing. I think partly because, and I don't know if you guys can relate to this, but it's so easy, isn't it? I think in life, generally, it's easy to compare yourself to others. But in the church, actually, you know, I think we can be the worst for that. And, you know, so I'd look at other people in our church community, wonderful people. But, you know, I looked to my own life and I thought, no, they're the people that will be pastors and worship leaders and all that kind of stuff. I just didn't I didn't feel like I fit that mold. But I continued to pray. Honestly, God nudged me. I feel like I tried to resist it quite strongly for must have been the best part of maybe a year, 18 months. And I did some traveling in that time. Like I went to, it's like, this is such a cliche gap year story. You know, I went to America and Israel and India and all of this kind of stuff. And it just, every time I kept pushing it away and tried to, it just kept nudging at me. And I was really focused on music at that point. And so really thought that was what I was going to do. And it just kept coming back. Justin Welby, actually, interestingly, always good to compare yourself to the Archbishop. he had a similar thing. You know, the way he describes the vocation was this sense of, you know, God just nudging his heart and he's sort of running away from it and God just calling him.
Yeah.
And and prophetic words, honestly, people speaking into my life, some, you know, at first that kind of freaked me out. And then it was a development of feeling God's calling over time.
Yes, brilliant. So you were at Cheriton Baptist Church, you know, a very kind of charismatic, a whirlwind. Shout out Cheriton Baptist.
Big
if
up.
Any of you are watching, love you guys. And, you know, you're now in the Church of England. How did you find yourself getting drawn to be, you know, in ministry in the Church of England, for instance, as opposed to why not Baptist Church or others?
Yeah. I think when I started thinking about Christian leadership, I remember there were two places that, and I thought they were basically the only two places in the country where you could go. it was Spurgeon's, which obviously, you know, and Charles Spurgeon, famous, you know, Baptist sort of training college, and a place called Roffey, which is a Kingdom Faith college. Both amazing places, you know. I'm not being disparaging at all, but that was very much kind of the universe of Bible schools that I knew about. And then I felt quite strongly to as I was sort of discerning the call to move to London, and there was a little Catholic college as part of the University of London called Heathrop, which is a very, very old college, but it was, you know, predominantly trains Catholic ordnance, got people that are going to become priests in the Catholic Church. And I felt really strong. I went for an open day there and I felt really strongly that that was where I was supposed to study. I think there was a fair bit of opposition to that. And people who loved me very much, I think, were very worried about that. You know, yeah, I remember people literally coming to my house and giving me brochures to, and I think that, you know, that's, it came from a place of love, but I think sometimes theologically we have a bit of a fear, don't we? We kind of, you know, we have all this language in the church of, you know, worried about getting led astray and other, you know, other kind of theologies and all the rest of it. And I was very adamant, and I was kind of like, no, I really think God's in this. And I went along, and I kind of, the narrative I had in my head was that I was going there to convert Catholics. And, you know, I like went with my Jesus culture shirt and the leather bound Bible, and you know, and that's what I thought, you know, God had sent me there for. And actually, to be really honest with you, I spent years being very, very humbled, meeting these guys who, you know, we wouldn't agree on every bit of theology, but they knew Jesus, they loved him, and, and better, you know, they knew him better than me.
Wow.
And it was a real moment for me, and I think probably that in culmination of living very near HTB and going there, I think probably, I think probably both of those things fed into me, you know, looking at getting ordained as a, in the Church of England.
Yeah, fantastic. Yeah. You mentioned HTB there, you know, many of us know of HTB, the Alpha course, so much. And you became, well, you started going there and then went into ministry through through being a member of HTB. Is that right? Yeah, tell us a bit about
it. Yeah, so I was a student when I started attending, and then I won't get into the granular detail of the discernment process. Everyone will fall asleep. But, you know, basically, that was, more words that I'd had when I was back in Kent were just confirmed being there. I had more sort of prophetic words and people speaking into my life, and honestly, people who were mentors to me, loving me, and, you know, and so that I started the discernment process there. And obviously, you know, HTB is, you know, just state the obvious, is on the sort of more charismatic evangelical side of the Church of England. So it wasn't, it wouldn't be particularly dissimilar to how maybe you guys worship or whatever. So it was, so that was kind of it over a period of time.
Yeah, fantastic. Yeah. So where do you train for the Church of England? How does that actually happen? Do you go to a, so you've already been to the college that you talked about, that was a Catholic college, and how did you get into training for the Church of England ministry and to be a Rev?
Yeah, so there's, I went to a place called St. Melitus College, and St. Melitus was, of course, that's right, the first Bishop of London. Well done.
And we know that.
I would have known that if I hadn't gone there. Yeah. So, but yeah, so I went to St. Melitus in, which is actually was, you know, it was a training college in partnership with Diocese of London and the Church of England and HTB. So it was quite a young college. And so I went there, trained for, and so that was 3 years training. And the way that works, if you're interested, is, you know, I did some more theology. So I did a master's in theology, and then the rest of my time I was placed in a ministry context. And I love that model, because it's kind of, you know, because we believe in the incarnation, don't we? You know, if we're learning things theologically that aren't being fleshed out in our devotion to Jesus, then it's pointless, isn't it?
Yeah, yes, well said. Good one, George. Yes, yeah, so you're now in Nottingham. That's are you still working out the sort of end stages of your full training, or are you completely trained now, as it were? How does it work?
Officially I'm all trained. So you finish your training and then you get ordained. Yeah. And then I was a deacon for a year, and now I'm a priest. And then I'm a curate up here. So you're then trained, you then start curacy, which is sort of assistant pastor. That's what I'm doing up here. And we're loving it. Honestly, I mean, it's interesting. We came up to Nottingham. Nottingham wasn't on our radar at all. And we actually moved up because a couple of friends of ours from London who are real heroes to us, and just people that really inspired us in our own faith, me and Kate, moved up here to plant a church. And we had, we had kept in touch with them and had known them for a long time. And so when the time came, we said, you know, we'd always loved the idea of leading a church together. It's amazing. Things came full circle and we ended up moving to Nottingham.
Fantastic. Yeah. Fantastic. So obviously all the churches have been experiencing, you know, this crazy time of lockdown and all the rest of it. What's been happening with Trinity Church in Nottingham during the lockdown phase? How have you been kind of dealing with that, and what sort of activities?
It's interesting, isn't it? I mean, there's no answers to any of this stuff in terms of, I don't think that I feel like I've read a million blogs on churches trying to discern exactly what God's doing in coronavirus. and it totally, ranges yeah. from like from the just crazy to the anyway whatever. But
yeah,
it's
yeah.
But yeah, I mean, honestly, I sort of feel as a church, we really feel that it's been all about devotion. So we've gone, so we have repurposed our website to be essentially a virtual prayer room. So that's what, that's really what we felt God call us into. And that was, and that made sense because obviously as good Anglicans, we were entering into Lent very much. And, we were fasting and praying during that time. Yeah. And obviously lockdown happened during Lent. And so there's, and it kind of felt like this sort of consecration moment of Lent being this thing of, of us emptying ourselves so we can be even more formed to know God and to empty ourselves so we can be even more full of Him. Mm-hmm. It kind of felt like, I don't know if you guys, but at least in the first month of lockdown, a bit of like an enforced wilderness, like a continuation of that, of that journey.
So
that's been, I would say we're quite tired. I don't know, I would just to be honest about it, I think we're all church online has amazing benefits, but it's exhausting as well, and I think we're all longing to just have some real contact because we're made for that, aren't we? Like the church,
we are.
I don't think
we
the church,
are.
Yeah, yeah, it's not the same.
So exactly. So I think we've in one sense, I mean, there were kind of two strands I felt with the church when lockdown started. On the one hand, it was like oh, isn't this an amazing opportunity? There's so many, and I really, I mean, to be honest, I started lockdown like that, hopelessly optimistic that this is amazing. Like, people are getting more local, more chances, to really embody the gospel around their neighbors and their friends, and you can't separate, you can't separate your sort of church life from your real life because they're on the same street. That was exciting. And at the same time, got friends who are doctors and nurses who are seeing the other side of it, which is, bereft families, you guys know this, you spent years in healthcare and of seeing way more of the grief and the trauma of it. And I think holding those two things in tension has been interesting. And, for me in particular, I think I've been spending a lot of time, in First Samuel and just thinking a lot about what it is to know God and to know His voice. And, really interestingly though, Samuel's mum, Hannah, if you remember the story, Samuel really starts with this, woman who loves God, just pouring out her anxiety and her anguish of not being able to have a child. And, and I love, for me, it's always inspired me that Hannah is able to be that honest with God, like a model of what we should be like in prayer and what, like really like giving our hearts over to Him.
Yeah.
But also for the time, Samuel then comes along and he really feels like this child, this promise of grief and faith, right? But both things come together. You've got sort of Hannah's faithfulness, I mean, who she knows God to be, and her grief and honesty about the anxiety she feels as a human being. So and so I feel like, what God's birthing, I don't think is just either one of those things. I think grief and faith together, lament and vision, I think are coming together in this time and don't necessarily need to choose, if that makes sense.
Yeah. Yes, yeah, that's great, George. Yeah, that's, very real. Yeah. And it's important that we're sort of real and authentic. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and so what are your thoughts as a leadership even about, when we physically start, there's some laxing of the rules and all the rest of it. Have you guys made any plans about what you might or might not be able to do in terms of having folks coming into the building or whatever?
No.
Yeah.
Thank God.
That's good to hear.
Oh gosh, guys. I mean, I feel like we have lots of conversations, but I mean, it's felt at the moment like living beyond a couple of weeks has seemed a bit crazy. And I think, I think there's probably themes that we would see. So there's stuff that I can't see us rowing back from. So particularly, in this time we've seen way more people be empowered to go and, into the ministries that they have, whether all, ordained or pastors or not. And that kind of the idea of the priesthood of all believers has come up in a particular way, and just seeing members of our congregation take the lead on that. I can't see us coming back from that. I mean, that would just be crazy. But in terms of, a strategy of, what church might look like, I think whatever happens now, church is more local. I think what God's, I really believe that what God's doing through this is getting us back, honestly, to the incarnation. Sometimes we can we can make the gospel almost too spiritual, can't we? And we forget that it is supposed to be fleshed out in our lives. And yeah. I love the idea that in this time, God's maybe forming us to be people who are integrated, you know, who don't, you know, go to church on Sunday and then, you know, live a different life during the week. But like the gospel becomes as not just about our words, but about, you know, a demonstration yeah. within our communities. And for us, that's been compassion's been a big part of that. So we've, you know, we've started a food bank for the first time. I know you guys do lots of things in Ashford as well. And it's been really interesting, like just seeing, seeing what God's doing through that. I was reading, Isaiah 58, and that bit where, you know, the fast that the Lord desires, you know, he says, you know, is it not to loose the bonds of the oppressed? That's, you know, right, is it not to feed the hungry and to clothe the naked? Yeah. And then the second part of that is that, you know, when you do these things, your light will break forth like the dawn, and the glory of the Lord will be your rear guard. It's almost this picture of revival.
Yes,
and I think sometimes we forget that, you know, Jesus is flesh and blood, that we celebrate communion in bread and wine, in real things.
Yeah.
And that Jesus is coming back to make this earth, these communities new, to make all things new, not some reality out there in the clouds, but to transform this society, to transform real lives. And I just think that, you know, that maybe some of what God's doing is to recenter us on that, on the basic gospel, and what it means to actually make the word flesh in our own lives and our communities. And I think when we're stepping into that, stepping into a deeper devotion and stepping into compassion, I think is going to be sowing the seeds for revival in our cities. I really believe that.
George, you are speaking prophetically to us, and I really appreciate that. Thank you for doing that. Thank you for being brave. And, you know, it's no accident this time, and very powerful thoughts. And thanks so much about it for it. You've mentioned, and sorry that we didn't in the introduction mention your beautiful wife, Kate, who is with you there. Is Kate working with you in the ministry, George?
Yes, she is. Yeah. So yeah. Kate, when we first moved up here, she was a secondary school teacher and then has felt called to come and join the team.
Fantastic.
So she tells me what to do all the time now. it used to be that it was just when she could finish work at now.
Brilliant, mate.
It's great working together, though, as a team, and is it? Husband and wife.
I should have said that first. It is.
There's a lot kicking under our table that no one sees.
Yeah, during this broadcast, I mean, the bruises down this side of my leg.
It's when you start kicking each other as well. Yeah. So Kate's working for the church as well, and and it's been really amazing. I mean, and, you know, even just in our own lives, I feel like this time for us has been. I feel like ultimately we don't want to leave this time the same. I'm just speaking personally now, you know, in terms of our marriage, and like, you know, Evelyn Underhill, who was this sort of quite well-known Anglican mystic, she said, you know, the most interesting thing about church is God, which we'd agree with. But, you know, she's basically making the point of that, you know, we can make our structures and institutions about so much else. And we've really felt in this time, like, just more deeply than I think we have done before, just this desire to know him, to know Jesus, to really hear his voice. And I think I've even, if I'm honest, even for me, like, I'm not anti-intellectual, but I feel like theology even becomes a distraction. I think there's times in my life where you know, it's so much easier to talk about God than it is to talk to him. You know, there's times where I'm like, I realize I spent an hour talking to someone about some like minutia of theology, and God's like, you could have talked to me. Everything flows from that. And this is, and we see this, you know, in Augustine, in Bonhoeffer, in the apostles, in modern day heroes of the faith, you know, Eugene Peterson, whoever you're, you know, all of these people, they're people that have fallen in love with Jesus. Like that, everything flows from that. And I think I've spent so much time thinking, you know, if I just read the right book, if I just get my head around the right ideas, then we'll be sorted. And I think all, you know, evangelism, compassion, you know, prayer ministry, our lives, whatever it is, it all flows from falling in love with him. Like, we have to know him, don't we? And then, you know, we don't have to think about doing evangelism when you're in love with Jesus. It just flows out. And I think that was why I think so much of the early church, many of the ideas that we have in church, they didn't have now. You know, the early church didn't talk about outreach and evangelism. You know, they didn't have an evangelism team. They were embodied. They understood that, you know, to be a fully integrated disciple of Jesus meant that we shared our faith. It meant that we loved the poor. We looked after the sick. It meant that we gave ourselves to knowing him, to breaking the bread, to sharing the scriptures. And that's, I'm excited to see that kind of discipleship coming back to the church.
Yeah, amen. I mean, it just flows from us when we're in that intimate relationship. And I've been thinking along the same lines at the moment, George. We're just so much going on in the world. My head has been like buzzing, you know, full and almost a bit foggy. And do you know what? I just keep bringing it back. And I had it this week, is like, have faith like a child. Just keep it simple. Just keep loving Jesus. Keep it simple. Just keep him as the center of your life. Just look to him in everything. Always go back to him. Always go back to a conversation with God, you know, and actually it makes things so much more stable and solid. And you can feel yourself just feeling secure in that and immovable.
And I totally agree. And you find that, I mean, even as Josie was singing about peace, you know, I was thinking about even fears in my own life, and even like fear of man's a huge one for all of us, you know, isn't it? And you find that as you do that, those things dissipate, because you know, I don't think that you become awake, I think, to the presence of God in your life and in all things. You know, you start seeing God in you know, in all manner of things, and you become awake to him, and you realize that he's what's really real. I mean, that's the thing, isn't it? That's what prayer does. That's what, for you know, is that what's most real, this microphone or this screen or whatever, what's most real is the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, is God, right? Is his kingdom. And you know, and our role is to make visible the kingdom that that's at hand and that's coming. And I think, like, I really believe that. I think so much of our Christian lives is rooted fundamentally in, like, what do we think is most real? You know, what are we most awake to in our lives? And we've all got busy lives. We're all doing different things. But I think for me, my practice now is to come more and more. I'm constantly praying, Lord, make me more awake to you. Make me more awake to you. Because if you're real, then everything else gets put in its proper place. If you're most real.
Fantastic. You know? Absolutely. This is gold. And thanks so much for sharing these things, George. You know, this is from God.
It is.
From God through you. And we're going to, you know, receive that from him. How can we pray for you and Kate, for Trinity Church Nottingham? And then we're going to pray for you, George, and we're going to get you to pray for us, and then we'll say ta-ra until next time. But how can we pray for you?
Well, firstly, I'd love, your worship leader was wearing a Bright City t-shirt, so I'd love prayer that I would get one of those through in the post.
I feel that might be answered.
I saw that, I was like, come on, surely it's time, Lord. But I think personally for me and Kate, we're tired, like a lot of us are. You know, we're really sort of last week running on fumes, loving what God's doing, but you know, feeling tired. And so we've actually got a week off next week. So would love some prayer for us personally, just selfishly.
Absolutely. We'd love to be charged. We're on it.
But I think it's as a community, I think our biggest prayer is that we keep saying yes to what it is God wants. I know that sounds so vague, but you know, our vision as a church is to see the church on fire and the city alive, and that all starts with the presence of God. And I think, you know, if we're in step with him, if we're able to respond to what, and I, you know, we're not always, we've got ideas, I'm not completely clear on what he is doing in this time, but I know that if we respond to it, we're going to see things beyond, I think, our wildest imagination.
Absolutely.
That's our prayer, will we respond to what the Spirit's doing.
Great, let's pray.
Okay.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for this divine connection. Thank you for George and Kate, what you're doing in their lives. Thank you for calling them for such a time as this. And thank you for the word that George has brought to us, such a very important word. And Lord, we ask that you bless them both. Lord, you would restore, renew, refresh, encourage, lift up, build up, fill them afresh with your streams of living water, Father. And thank you that as they've been giving out so much, Lord, you would refresh and renew them. And Lord, we give them a wonderful holiday. Yeah. Give them a beautiful break. Give them joy, fun, laughter, healing and restoring. Mm. Thank you, Lord. And we thank you for what you're doing in Trinity Church, leading them step by step. And Lord, pour out, do over, above and beyond anything George and all the team would even think or imagine for your glory as they follow you with honesty and integrity and being true to themselves and to what you are saying to them. Lord, you know, you just do amazing things. Yes. We know that. And do it for your glory. Yes, be glorified in their lives. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Mm-hmm. Amen. And George, would you pray for Bright City? Yes. You know, and you know, what you've shared and what you've brought, honestly, they are prophetic words for us about the incarnation, about, you know, getting back to the intimacy with God and knowing and loving him. Yes.
Oh, great. Let me pray. Thanks. Let me pray. Maybe if you're watching now, you're at home, just want to open your hands, whatever you usually do, just to receive what God has. And Lord, I thank you that you are not far off. You're not sitting on a cloud somewhere. Lord, in Jesus, you have come close. The tiredness that we feel, the joy that we feel when we're low and when we're abounding, Lord, you know it all. Jesus, you are so close. You are so real. And Lord, I want to thank you that even as you're risen now and you're present with us by your Spirit, you still have scars on your hands. You still know what it is to live in the tension between the now and not yet, Lord, that you've come, but that you're coming again. And I pray, Lord, that would bring hope to people today.
Amen.
Lord, I pray that that people would know that you are closer than they could possibly imagine, that you're longing to speak to them. And I just, you know, believe there's just a few people today that even we mentioned Samuel earlier, but even as Samuel said, speak, Lord, your servant's listening, just to ask him, just to open yourself up to his voice. And Lord, I just pray by your Holy Spirit, would you come and speak to people now in Bright City Church, Lord? Yes, I pray that there would be an outpouring of your Spirit, that this would be a people who are led by your Spirit, who hear your voice, that are used to hearing your voice, that it becomes normal for them, that are so awake to your presence in every moment, that know that you are most real in every circumstance. And Lord, I just pray, would you pour your Spirit out upon now, Lord, where there are hungry hearts, even around Ashford as I'm speaking, Lord, I pray, would you speak? Would you pour your Spirit out?
Yes, Lord.
And I pray, Lord, I do pray for living water to flow from and through this church. Just see water coming. Me and Ian talked about this yesterday, but just see water coming down streets and into homes, and even taps in the Spirit, taps that have been dried up and aren't working. I see God just turning on and opening up wells. And Lord, we thank you that you have done so through Kent. You brought so much of your gospel as people arrived in Kent. Your gospel, the good news of your kingdom, spread throughout England. And we thank you for the prayers that have been prayed throughout history. And I pray that Bright City would step into the legacy that you have for Ashford, for that region. Amen. And Lord, I pray that we would see revival in these days. We'd see the goodness of the Lord, your goodness in the land of the living.
Yes, Lord.
So Lord, I pray, would you make us awake? Would you bless Rachel and Ian? Would you pour your Spirit upon them? Would you pour out even more anointing upon them as they lead and envision this church as you've placed them here? And Lord, I pray that all of this in your name, to your glory.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. George, it's been such a pleasure and a joy. Great to see you. Thanks for blessing us all. And we'll keep in touch, of course, and hopefully have you on again in the not-too-distant future.
Love it. Such an honour. Thanks for having me.
Bless you, George.
We love you lots.
Love to Kay.
Love to Kay.
Bye, guys.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Great.
Wow.
Let's go back to our main screen. Thank you, everyone, for being together, being with us. And wasn't it a great treat to have George? Have a lovely afternoon. We're over time now. Enjoy your Sunday lunch, maybe a walk out. Rach and I are hoping to get out for a little walk across the fields.
And get some rest.
get some lovely rest as well, if you can. And lots of love. We miss you. Miss being together physically, but it's so good to be together like this. Some of you may be having a virtual coffee after this together with your life groups, those who can. Enjoy that if you can, and we'll see you next time. Don't forget about the very special broadcast on Tuesday, where we'll be looking at those racism matters together. God bless you. Keep praying. Keep loving.
Yes.
Keep enjoying God. And we're going to play out with who's given us the song this week?
Well, okay, so the song this week is from Vicky.
Thank you, Vicky.
Vicky, this is your song. It's called, what's it called now? And I believe, just waiting for this to go. And so, yes, here we go. What a Friend by Matt Maher.
Turn it up.
Everybody aside and temptation. Everybody knows heartbreak, isolation. But we can lay our burdens down. Lay our burdens down. What a friend we have in Jesus.
Bye.
God bless.